people, by the way, for people saying this is the new normal and everything has changed, let me point you to 1919, okay? little thing called the worldwide influenza pandemic, incorrectly called the Spanish flu. We got back to normal because the human race, in 1918, 1919, the human race was aware that pandemics happen. We're undergoing this psychological trauma of a year and 3 months ago, of feeling like nothing has ever happened like this. We're the first ones to experience it. And the overuse of the word unprecedented by people who are making our decisions is what was disappointing to me. You have a director of public health who's whatever, PhD in social health. Was she unaware that there was a really, really big worldwide pandemic, right? Part of it right here in L.A. County.
Never happened before.
And he'll be saying unprecedented about a pandemic. He said, no, point in fact, they're consistently, you can count on them in human history. The two most influential things in all of human history are war and disease. And you can count on them. There's not going to be, we're not going to be post-disease now. You know, the one superpower of the 21st century was absolutely male chicken blocked by the country of its origin because they could have been super transparent, but they were not. And so we lost the opportunity to contain it early. And so the lessons from 102 years ago when 650,000 Americans died in just a few months' time, when we were only a third our size right now, we squandered them. We wasted them. So what price your technology now, Crozier? I asked. You know what they knew back in 1918 was it's coming. There's no zero death scenario. We have to try to maintain as much normality as we can until it passes by. And then it passes by and we're right back open.
Do you do any home improvements to like a living room or create any sort of like a viewing experience differently than what it was before the pandemic at home?
Yeah, we definitely took our viewing a little more seriously, moved things around in the living room, got big overstuffed chairs.
Right.
Apparently the dogs feel are theirs, but we took our game up a notch. And then I moved sort of my computer workstation. I moved it out to the living room and then canted it 45 degrees so I can sit there all day long, you know, catching the news, and all that. But otherwise,
because I revamped that whole living room, got a new TV, painted the wall black, did the lights behind the TV, soundbar, all that stuff. And I like going to the theaters, but I just know I'm not going to go to a theater as much as I used to. For no reason other than I got a nice little setup at home now.
Yeah. The one thing that I did, and it was January of last year, because I knew what was coming.
Yeah.
On January 24th, I did a groundbreaking, predictive show.
Unprecedented?
Except for Orson Welles and the War of the Worlds. And what I did is I actually, on Google Maps, I actually traced out a 1/8 mile track, a lap on my property. And so I measured it, you know, right down to the meter, and then I added like kettlebells here, a battle rope there, a little dip machine there, and then ever seen a mace bell? It's a kettlebell with a long long steel handle. You can swing it around.
Oh right, yes,
yeah,
sure.
It's pretty cool. So that's what I did. I'm lacking any more excuses. It forced me to wake up every morning at 5 a.m. and walk, you know, at least 1 mile with the dogs, and then, you know, stop and maybe do 1 minute of intense exercise and stuff. I'm glad I did. I'm glad I did. I feel better, and I was, by golly, I was not going to let this coronavirus be the boss of me. And I didn't want to come out of this with, like, a heart attack or something. So that's one thing I did. All right, take a break. When we come back, the Sheriff Villanueva has three things that are going to kill L.A. When we come back, it is the Tim Conway Jr. Show, KFI M640, live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app.
It's Trinity.
Shannon chimed in.
Let's talk about rectums, shall we?
Yeah, I think we should redo that, because I totally missed that was the thing. I thought you were talking about at 9 o'clock.
Mm-hmm. Oh!
Oh, gotcha.
Do that you have something for the DDSA?
No.
Oh. We were just bringing you in, Tootsie.
Oh, okay. You know, and here's the thing. Like, it's Joe Biden. Here's the thing. Okay, what do you think?
Come on, man.
So, of course, that, you know, Petros singing the theme to Timmy Time, a cartoon I'd never seen before.
Neither.
And so, Tim, it took months. Tim finally sets up an interview with the guy that wrote that and sung it, I guess. He's an English guy, because it was an English show. And the guy happened to be visiting relatives here in L.A., and so he had told Sharon, well, I'm going to be there in the States in a few months, so let's make sure we do this. So, you know, all this buildup, and the guy is going to be here, and he can only do this one day. They knew that. And that was the day I was filling in. Tim set this up for a year, and I'm falling in. I'm like, what's the bit? And Sharon's like, well, he's going to come to the studio. I was, well, but he's the English guy who wrote the song. Yeah. But he didn't sing it. He just wrote the song. Yeah, it'll be great. I mean, after that question, so what's it like being the guy who wrote the Timmy Time song? I'm fresh out of follow-ups.
Written any other songs?
And I didn't know. And I, you know, I got here, whatever, it's 4:35, and, you know, and said, so what do we got? What do we got cooking tonight, Chiefs? Oh, it'll be so great because we have this guy coming in. And I said, doesn't that sound like the kind of thing that Tim should be here for? And she said, well, he couldn't make it because, you know, he's on vacation this week. I said, isn't that the kind of thing that he should have thought of a year ago when he booked the dude to come on? So it was one of the most uncomfortable hours. It was like an hour. The guy, they scheduled him to come in for an hour. And
what?
Yeah. Because awesome. They, you know, he's here. They drove from up from Orange County or something. I believe it's in the Radio Hall of Fame. We're selling it as an NFT.
I love it.
So, I never told him that. But I did the best I could. Just that I was absolutely coming into it, absolutely cold. I didn't, you know, I didn't know where that song was from. But then I find out that Petros and Tim both, you know, show their kids. I never heard of it.
That definitely sounds fun.
My daughter was never into the cartoons in general. Well, anime, but not Timmy the goat or whatever, the lamb. And so I didn't know it. I didn't know it at all. And, you know, obviously a song has to be written by somebody. So he was the guy that wrote it. And that was where, you know, that was the extent of my questions. We got on far better about places in common that we have been that I've been in the UK, that he'd been in Canada, the US. Those weren't very compelling questions. Well, you know, the legal world left a giant today. F. Lee Bailey, famously one of the dream team that got a not guilty verdict for O.J. Simpson after he beheaded his wife and killed the Ron Goldman, her friend, allegedly, if you believe that. And then later on, he wrote the book. What was the book called? I Didn't Do It, But If I Did, Here's How It Was. Something like that. It had some really weird circular title. So anyway, when it comes to dealing with loss, I like to turn to OJ for words of comfort. Here's OJ from a couple hours ago on the on loss and its impact on him.
Hey, Twitter world. You know, unfortunately, the older you get, you start losing friends. And recently, I've lost a number of friends.
Your kids would know about that.
But today I found out that I lost a great friend. His name was F. Lee Bailey, one of the great lawyers of our time. I call him Flea. He hated it. Right. What's interesting is this was the week he finally finished a book that he wanted to write before his life was over. and it was a book about my trial and his take on the trial itself and you know, some of the facts that maybe the public hadn't wasn't aware of.
Was the world holding its breath for this book? The F. Lee Bailey version of the O.J. trial? I mean, is there a single account from any angle that has not been written yet? I don't know what Flea, as O.J. called him, was going to bring to the table. And then O.J. takes another 30 seconds, all about him. And then here's the wrap-up on that.
This little lockup cell that they used to have me in before the trials to talk to me and tell me what to expect that day. He was great. He was smart, sharp as ever. I haven't read his book yet, but normally I read nothing about that case. But that is one book I'm looking forward to reading. F. Lee Bailey.
Should I spoil it for him and tell him how it ends? Is that yeah? But wouldn't O.J. pretty much be able to write that book? But he sends his friend.
Maybe
off.
The best lawyer of our time, of his generation, but a great guy. God bless his family. God bless you, Lee. You'll be missed by me. Take care.
Oh, he lost.
Is he crying now?
He did. Well, yeah, he's doing a little, in some of the tweets, he's done the fake cry, the Jimmy Kimmel cry, but here's...
God bless his family. God bless you, Lee. You'll be missed by me. Take care.
Well, you know, in F. Lee Bailey's defense, he did help keep you out of jail for the murder of your children's mother, so... So I'd be crying too, I guess. It is really. Is it me or is he just owning the lack of self awareness at this point? There's a part of me that thinks that he has one over on us. He has us all thinking he's not self aware, but I think he knows that he gets to say this kind of stuff because he didn't go to jail for that. He went to jail for. Whatever, bum-rushing the room with the guns and all that. Which always, he has taken his stuff back, but he is brandishing a firearm and then also kidnapping people. But again, O.J. on loss.
Hey, Twitter world. You know, unfortunately, the older you get, you start losing friends. And recently, I've lost a number of friends.
Okay, well, insert Nicole Kidman.
You start out with, Nicole. Hey, Twitter world.
Yeah, yeah. Because, wait...
Hey, Twitter world.
There you go. So, and for the record, he has 901,000 followers. So, a lot of people. We'll be back right after this. It's the Tim Conway Jr. Show. Brian sits filling in for Tim. KFI AM 640 live everywhere on the iHeartRadio app. Michael Crozier with him. And what went on today is with Federal OSHA and Cal OSHA is they're talking about your July. They're trying to come up with mask guidelines for late July. And this is what they came up with. Well, first of all, on the OSHA one, someone who said it on the call said OSHA is working at both federal and state levels to continue mask requirements. Over the last 2 days, I've been on two OSHA calls. Federal level, they give no information. You can't ask questions. Just talk at them and hope to influence.